My name is Cliff Robertson, and this is I've Got a Secret.
I've Got a Secret, brought to you tonight by Tony, creator of fine beauty products for the woman who prefers the natural look of beauty care at home. Now, from New York, here is I've Got a Secret, starring Gary Moore.
Thank you very much, my friends. Welcome to yet another edition of I've Got a Secret with the same sterling personnel as follows. On our panel, we have Bill Cullen and Betsy Palmer.
Good evening.
And Henry Morgan.
Hi there.
And Bess Myerson. And that's the bunch. And with those stirring answers from our panel, we will greet our first contestants, please. Will you come in? Oh, the chair almost got away from you, didn't it? All right, now let's find out what the names of these young gentlemen are and where they're from. We'll start with you, son.
Gary Dodge.
Gary Dodge. And where are you from, Gary?
Houston, Texas.
Houston, Texas. Let's take the young fellow back here.
Gary Carswell, and I'm from Houston, Texas.
Gary Carswell, also from Houston, Texas.
Gary Schulke, and I'm from Houston, Texas.
And there's Gary Schulke, and he is from Houston, Texas. And right here?
Gary Dyer.
Gary Dyer, from where?
Houston, Texas.
What do you know? Houston, Texas. And your name?
Gary Merrick from Houston, Texas.
Gary Merrick from Houston, Texas. And your name?
Gary Hansen.
Gary Hansen.
From Houston, Texas.
From Houston, Texas. Well, now, if you six Garys will lean in and whisper your secret to this Gary, we'll show it at the same time to our audience at home. Now, how about that? All right, to help classify these Gary's secrets, the clue concerns something they have, and Betsy Palmer, we'll start with you, please.
All right. Do you all have the same thing, all of you Garys? Is it...
Yep.
Besides your name being Gary, I mean. Is
yep.
that part of it?
Pardon?
Is that part of it, that your names are all Gary? Is that part of your secret?
Not really, no. It wasn't really. Stated. It just happens to be a small coincidence.
I bet. Does it have anything to do with you physically? Does
nope.
it have anything to do with the rest of your name, like your middle name?
Have anything to do with your middle name?
Does it have anything to do with anything that you have done in school?
No. Nope. All right, we've lost $20. We have 60 more to go. We go, please, to Henry Morgan.
Were you fellas named after Gary Moore?
You weren't named after me, were you? None of you.
A pretty silly question, right?
Yes. Anybody who would do that to their child doesn't deserve to have them.
I thought it was a brilliant question. Now, there's got to be something here that's so obvious, I'm not seeing it.
Maybe they all have oil wells.
Does it have anything to do with politics?
Anything to do with politics, boys? Nope.
Does it have anything to do with your parents?
Oh, well, indirectly it does. Indirectly.
Does each of you have a father named Gary?
Nope.
A mother?
$40 down, no. $40 down, $40 to go. We go, please, to Bess Myerson.
Indirectly to do with your parents. Is that mentioned in the secret?
No, it's not mentioned. It's implied.
Implied. Was it any kind of... Did it happen at birth, when you were born? No.
No.
Is it some kind of a contest, perhaps, that you were entered in?
No, no contest.
This thing that you have, do you have it with you? Yes?
Yes.
Can I see it?
Me
from here?
From where you're sitting? Huh?
Is it in your pocket? Do you have it in your pocket? Is it something that you don't carry with you? It's not a physical object, right?
Well, Garys, I think we have to say it's a physical object. Whether you say you carry it with you, I would say the use of the word carry is no. $60 down, $20 to go, and we go, please, to Bill Cullen.
Is it living?
Is it living? Yep.
Is it a person?
Yes.
Is it a brother or brothers?
And you all have brothers back there named...
Gary.
Are they all the same name, your brothers? I mean, do you all have...
What now?
Not Gary, but do you all have brothers named Nell,
for instance?
I mean, but do you all have brothers with the, with other names that are similar, like...
I know what you mean. What you mean is, do they have six brothers, all of whom share the same name?
That's right.
All right. The secret these boys have is that each of them has a twin brother. Let's have the curtain open and we will meet their twins. Now, boys, move over and join your brothers. Stand next to your brothers. I hope I've got my cards right here. Now, here, I'd like to reintroduce these boys to you. Here is Larry and Gary Carswell. Larry and Gary Schulke. Larry and Gary Dyer. Larry and Gary Merrick. Larry and Gary Dodge. And finally, Larry and Gary Hansen. All identical twins. Now, fellas, you all live in Houston, isn't that right? Houston or suburbs. Do any of you, do you play together? In other words, you're not really buddies. This is not a bunch of parents who got together and said, wouldn't it be cute if we did this thing? Now, if you think that this is an amazing statistic... I didn't mean that the way it, you know, you know. But I was going to say, if you think that this is statistically amazing to have six sets of twins all named Larry and Gary living so close to each other, if we'd had the budget, you would be seeing 29 more sets of twins, all named Larry and Gary, and all living in Houston or its suburbs.
Oh, that's
29 more. There is a club in Houston to whom we are indebted, the Mother of Twins Club, and they uncovered this startling fact for us. All right, Larrys and Garys, give my regards to all the other Larrys and Garys when you get home. Your prize money will be waiting off stage. And now, Larrys and Garys, clear of feet! They're all so pleased with themselves, isn't that nice? We'll be back with you again in just a minute, but first let's watch this.
Try White Rain Shampoo. So rainwater soft, it rinses twice as clean. And White Rain leaves hair sunshine bright, as if it were brushed with sunshine. Crystal Clear or White Rain Lotion Shampoo. And here's the home permanent made especially for gray hair, Silver Curl, with a special hair beauty treatment that prevents dryness and leaves gray hair soft and bright. Silver Curl by Tony.
What'd you say, Bill?
I was thinking whether kids were named after, they weren't named after you. I thought maybe they were named after Gary Boldwater.
We're not named after Gary Boldwater.
No, we're not, are we?
Now let's meet our special...
No friend of mine. I never saw this. I thought
it was amusing.
No.
Or I wouldn't have asked you to repeat it. Our special guest this evening is one of Hollywood's brightest young leading men and certainly one of the busiest. You will see him soon in... he's playing the part of John F. Kennedy in the movie PT-109. Obviously, the story of President Kennedy's wartime experiences. And he's now working on a new MGM Seven Arts movie, a comedy called Sunday in New York, which, surprisingly enough, is being filmed right here in New York. Here is Mr. Cliff Robertson. Welcome home.
Thank you.
But you did spend some time around here, didn't you?
Very hungry days.
Well, you have to have those before you can get the kind of days you're having now. And panel, Cliff has brought along a different kind of game for you to work on tonight, one that is going to test your powers of deduction. Cliff will read a brief mystery story to you. The story contains all the clues you need to figure out the solution. You got an example there, Cliff?
Larry? Gary? For example, I'm sure you've all heard the classic about the man who lived on the 21st floor of the large apartment house. Every morning when he went to work, he rode down in the self-service elevator. However, when he came home at night, He took the elevator up only to the 14th floor and walked the rest of the way up to his apartment. How come?
All right, panel, I think you all know that as a kind of a classic. Well, Henry,
I'm not brilliant, it's just that I know it from somewhere. The fellow was a midget, and he could only reach the button at 14, and he couldn't reach any higher, so he got off at the...
Going down in the morning, he could reach the one, the lowest one that said lobby. Coming home, he could only reach as high as 14. There's the answer. Now, we got some more of these things, haven't we? We found in a book here?
Yes, Gary.
It's a book, by the way, called How Come? A Book of Riddles, collected by Agnes Rogers. So, what's the setup for our first one?
Well, I came across some more here that I never heard of before that I read in the book. One was a man walking about during the course of his daily occupation, brushed against a rock and tore his sleeve. A few minutes later, he was dead. How come?
Betsy, how come? We'll show the audience what the answer is so that you can follow the deduction. Simple, huh? He was walking around during the course of his daily occupation, brushed against a rock and tore his sleeve. A few minutes later, he was dead. How come?
Are you going to do it?
Well, no, sweetheart, you do it.
Well, no, I was going to say that the way my mind works...
Yeah, I'm afraid of this.
He's a suicidal tailor, that's what he...
No, that he evidently worked outside, and he might have brushed against a rock that fell loose, and he fell over a cliff and was killed.
Yes, that's probably it, a falling rock.
No.
Happened to brush his sleeve. And killed him.
All right, Henry.
No, this is to get Betsy off the hook and show that she does have a great mind, because I'm just as stupid as I thought. I thought, you know, he brushed against this rock in falling down a well.
Bill's got an idea.
I just happen to know this now that everyone... Oh, go ahead. If you don't know.
He's a window washer.
No.
And he brushed against the rock.
What's kind of the rock doing in the window?
And he fell down.
A rock skyscraper made of rocks.
He was a... I didn't guess that. I had heard it. He was a deep sea diver, I think, and it ripped his...
Oh, and it's
all right.
Oh,
very good.
What have you got for
Miss Bess here? Bess, you better listen carefully. This one's a little tricky.
Bess, a commando dressed completely in black... His face was painted black, too. Was walking along a country road. The road was not lighted, and there was no moon. Suddenly, an automobile came tearing along at 70 miles an hour with its headlights off. But in spite of this, the driver saw the commando and stepped on his brakes in time. How come?
All right, here's the answer to how come all that.
The commando was walking along a dark road.
Simple and obvious.
Lights off.
The commando was carrying a flashlight.
Hello,
Did he wear a parachute?
Commando?
Well, maybe he smiled.
No.
And his teeth lit up.
The car wasn't going.
Yes, it was going 70 miles an hour.
70 miles an hour.
Right. Henry?
What?
I have no idea yet.
All right, Bill Cullen, the buzzer went, but Bill, what would you say?
It was broad daylight.
Absolutely right.
Oh.
It was broad daylight.
How do you know
he read the book.
Did you read the book, Bill?
No,
if
I didn't.
If you did, I wish you'd tell me the answer to
them. I didn't read the book, but I didn't guess them either, Cliff. I had heard them. We bunch of us get together sometime when the cards aren't going well, and we play, you know, this type of thing, but I hadn't.
Well, probably our best deductive mind on the long run is Henry. So let's see how Henry comes out.
All right, Henry, this is a murder mystery. For weeks, John was obsessed with the idea of getting rid of his nagging wife, Mary. His chance came one night when they went to a horror movie. During the scariest part of the picture, when many women in the audience were screaming, John stabbed Mary to death. After the movie, he took her out exactly as he had brought her in, and nobody suspected a thing. How come?
We will tell our audience now how come that.
His wife?
All right.
His wife? He brought in?
They were in a movie.
In a movie.
And during the course of the movie, he stabbed her?
Yes. At the point, the scariest part of the movie when all the women screamed.
Did he kill her?
Yes. Dead.
Killed her dead.
And you said he left the same way they came in?
With her.
Well, she wasn't in exactly the same condition, but they went out together the same way they came in together. dead.
She was
alive.
Now, were they in sitting in the audience when this happened?
They were with the rest.
They were in the audience,
yes.
Audience
with the people.
And they were sitting.
This one I got. This one I got.
You
oh,
got
maybe
it?
They came in wheelchairs.
Bill.
I think I have.
What, Beth?
Maybe
what?
They came in wheelchairs together. Maybe he came in or he just pushed her out.
I built it.
Go ahead.
Was it a drive-in movie?
Yes!
That one I didn't hear.
Now, there is no group so smug as a group of people who know the answer, you know. So this time, you're going to have to play without the answer. You'll have to guess yourself. This is for everybody. What about it, Cliff?
Once upon a time, the last known members of a wealthy and prominent European family died, and the courts began a search for an heir to the estate. Two young men showed up, both claiming to be long-lost relatives. Each had convincing documentary proof. The judge, in desperation, proposed a simple blood test to establish the identity of the true heir. One man agreed to take the test, the other refused. The judge thought a while and then said that the man who had agreed to take the test was the imposter. How come?
Henry?
You can't have a blood test on dead people.
These were two live people.
I know, but they had to compare the blood to somebody's. You see, just taking a blood test is ridiculous when you're trying... You have to have somebody to compare it to.
Maybe the other one was anemic.
You said these people had died, didn't you?
I think I better read this again.
These people are dead, you can't compare the live guy's blood to the dead people's
you're
blood.
You're right, and that's
no, read just the first sentence, if you will, Cliff.
Once upon a time, the last known members of a wealthy and prominent European family died, and the courts began a search for an heir to the estate.
Well, the whole thing is a fairy tale.
This
no.
does not preclude.
Oh, once upon a time,
once
it's not true.
No. It's not true.
No, it's the Romanovs or the hemophiliac family, and the real Romanov couldn't take the blood test because
it was not the Romanovs. It was the Spanish nobility, and the Spanish nobility suffered from hemophilia, which means if you take a blood test, you never stop bleeding.
They didn't say it was Spanish nobility.
Said European.
We would have known.
Well, they're not going to let you know
anything. Henry, you want friends in Europe?
Cliff, you want a job in addition to the one that you've got?
I need another job now.
Well, you come take mine. You can see what I'm up against there.
Yeah.
Cliff has to start shooting tomorrow morning out at Idlewild for his new picture. Thank you very much for sparing this evening.
Thank you.
Cliff Roberts. Now, my friends, do you remember this famous question? Which twin has the Tony? Well, tonight, 15 years later, here are the twins that made that ad, Ella and Lila Wigren. Now, which twin had the Tony, actually?
I did. In fact, I have one now.
Uh-huh. Well, then, Lila, you had the beauty shop treatment. Do you still have it?
Not anymore, Gary. After we made the ad, I started to use Tony, too. Of course, Tony has improved a lot since then.
Mm-hmm.
It's just great, I think.
Well, she is right, Lila is. Now, Tony has no mix neutralizer, three waving lotions, and hidden body to hold the shape of any hairstyle. And you can buy this special Tony right now. It has 42 free curlers in three sizes to make your Tony easier to set into style. And see how soft Tony leaves your hair and how manageable, too. One thing, do twins always think alike?
No, but we always agree on important things.
Important things, like Tony. So get this special Tony today. Save up to $1.49. And thank you, ladies, very much. Well, now, where are we? Oh, we are just in time to...
What?
Just in time to find my place in the cards, and I found it. Panel, a few weeks ago, Susie Parker was on our show wearing a beautiful dress made of a fabric designed by an 8-year-old girl. This inspired us to have Henry and Bill create some designs that we could turn into dresses for Betsy and for Bess. Now, in case you have forgotten what they look like, here are those original finger paintings by Bill Cullen and Henry Morgan.
Yeah.
No, they look nice. They really
did.
Very, very pretty.
All right, now, whoops. Now, You will notice the subtle delicacies of Henry's picture. This is Henry's over here, right?
It's upside down.
Oh, I beg your pardon. It's upside down. Well, correct.
No.
Notice the subtle delicacy as opposed to Bill's bold and solid work. Now, we knew at once these unique designs would make beautiful dresses for Bess and for Betsy, so we took the paintings to Custom Fabrics Incorporated here in New York and asked them to transfer these designs to silk. They did, and just wait until you see how these extraordinary prints turned out. Bess, can you come out front and center, please, and stand up here on our little models podium? Here we go. Now, Bess, we thought that Henry's design most suited you. Although the fabric has been printed, unfortunately, we just didn't have the time to have your dresses made up, but don't worry, we can do it right here tonight.
Oh, good.
We have a gentleman who will create a dress for you while you wait. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Alphonse Berger, better known as the Great Drapeau. Let me go. Yes, there's been a slight mistake here. This is Bill's, but it doesn't make any difference.
Okay, I got it, too.
Little judicious use of elastic there.
Are you all right? You're going to stop my circulation.
That dress can only improve your circulation. Look how it's coming along with ruffles at the waist, or just below the waist. And that is actually Bill's print, is it not? That's Bill's print.
It's pretty.
It's my mistake.
Did it come out? It's amazing. No, they didn't.
He's a very nice gentleman. I talked to him with some... Betsy, if you'll come out here. Now, we're going to ask the Great Drapeau to just be kind of technical advisor on this. If you'll get us the other print, sir, Henry and Bill.
Oh, pretty.
Based on what you saw the Great Drapeau do, you are going to create
a
gown
for Bess.
Oh,
they're not.
Oh, yes, they are.
We are?
Yes, you are. Yeah.
You
want to
throw it? Don't throw it.
All right, go to it, friend.
Wait, you want a high or low?
Wait a minute, you got a real dress in there. What?
Now, you're not really. Now, Pete, no. I'm a mummy.
Henry's got, at last, he's got Betsy right where he wants. I think we better leave this up to the expert. That was a nice try and great sport. Well, let's turn it back over to the Great Drapeau. Sir, you've got a chance to start from scratch on this really very starting frame.
Very, very beautiful. Isn't that lovely? Whoops, there goes my nose.
The colors, by the way, the very dark color is a brilliant, brilliant blue. The color inside the kind of little open rectangles is a brilliant yellow, and the remainder of it is white, and it really makes a startlingly beautiful print, doesn't it?
I just want to know that...
Do the ladies get to keep these prints? They get to keep these prints, in case you want to...
just beautiful,
really. Have a knapsack made out of them or something.
Can we have dresses? I'm going to have a dress made out of it.
Sure. Yeah. I'm thinking of having a jacket made out of the one Bess has got on. Right.
given you a job, have you?
We have 45 seconds, Mr. Drapo, the great Drapo. And with the use of two pins and two pins only,
yes,
his creative, what do we call this, the Eugenie look?
Oh, I've gotten a little hippie, I think, these days.
And I have to give you 5 seconds, sir, and we're off the air if you don't get us in 5 seconds. And in 5 seconds, he's going to do it. And he's got little boots in front.
Now, I've got a secret I want to share. My family suddenly loves salad, and that's a switch. Here's what did it. I started using Good Seasons Italian Salad Dressing Mix. You try it. It's different from bottled dressings. One of the world's greatest recipes, zesty, with flavor you can't find in bottled dressings. You make it different, fresh. Use this handsome bottle for mixing and serving. It's free when you buy the mix attached. Follow measurements marked. Just add salad oil and vinegar to the mix. There's Italian dressing, touched with garlic, onions, sweet red peppers. And it always comes out perfect. Here's flavor you can't find in bottled dressings. Why don't you share my secret tomorrow? Try Good Seasons Italian Salad Dressing.
Good Seasons, another fine product of General Foods.
Well, friends, we have here in this final shot something so that you can contrast to see how closely, as a matter of fact, the studio audience, I believe, will attest to the fact that the way these fabrics came out, they are really a faithful reproduction and quite handsome, don't you think? Yes. Really?
Please, Bill.
Next week, our special guest will be Robert Goulet. And until then, yeah, goodbye out there.
Here's a test to show you what Tame Cream Rinse can do. This girl rinsed half her hair with Tame. Tame is taken into the hair to condition it. This side without Tame tangles. Rinsed with Tame, tangle-free. Without Tame, dry, fly away. With Tame, manageable and shining. Yes, it's a shame to shampoo without Tame. Tame Cream Rinse.
For extra dry or color-treated hair, use Extra Conditioning Tame.
I've Got a Secret has been brought to you tonight by the Tony family of home permanents, including Tonette.
Oh, the permanent maid was the younger woman of mine.
The preceding program was pre-recorded. This is John Cannon speaking.
Oh, it's fun, isn't it?
And who subscribes to it?
Go on. Push the button.
Think of the fun you could have on
the tube.
The tube.
You.
Tube.
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 TV tubes.
That's a lot of fun, isn't it?
It's going to be a lot more fun
if you keep going the way you're going.
Go on.
Push the button.
Please subscribe. Subscribe.
I hope they're watching.